Good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship. We are grateful for your presence and the opportunity to see your smiling faces here in person. We're grateful for those joining us in the virtual world as well, and we welcome you. Several announcements we want to share on the bulletin on the backside. First and foremost, I want to thank everybody that came, participated, helped, dined at our pancake fundraiser yesterday. It was probably the best attempt of the three that we've had. So we're very grateful for that. About $350 we raised for our food and outreach ministries, which is a wonderful and an exciting blessing for us. So something to really be grateful for, and we're thankful for those that showed up early and that helped flip pancakes and sausage and bacon in and greet our guests and our congregation as folks came through the door. So a wonderful, wonderful day yesterday. Coming up this week, Sunday, a week from today, I want to remind everybody we will have a luncheon in the fellowship hall followed by a church council meeting. So do make plans for that, and we'll talk a little bit more through the week of menu, but it will be covered dish as it has been in the past. And we welcome and invite everybody to come and join us for that. Saturday, May 13th is the Northern District Celebration and Mission Event, 2 o'clock at First United Methodist Church downtown. And we'll be taking all of our collected items at that time. And if you haven't had the opportunity to donate and you would still like to, we're going to continue to collect items through next Sunday. So next Sunday is going to be the cutoff. We'll kind of move everything over since next week's a Communion Sunday. We'll move everything over and continue to collect things. But again, bring them in, and we will prepare to get them for the Celebration Mission event on the 13th. I had another thought in my mind, an announcement, and away it went. Fast thought. All right, if I think of it, I'll let you know. Any other announcements to share? Oh, I remember what it was. It came back to me. It's part of the Celebration Commission, and I just couldn't think of what it was. They're doing a cornhole tournament with the as part of the Celebration Commission event. It is $20 per two-person team to join, and if anybody would like to enter a team, we can enter as many teams as we would like to, but we would love to have some participation from our congregation with that. So if you're interested, let me know. Again, $20 per two-man team. We'll talk Sunday at our council meeting, and we might be willing to sponsor those teams. But let me know if you're interested. Again, as many teams as we would like to put in. What a wonderful, wonderful opportunity just to share and some fellowship together. And all of those funds raised go to the overall Celebration and Mission Event project for the conference. And then all of that money is distributed amongst all of the Celebration and Mission Event projects and mission sites. Any other announcements to share this morning? Very good. Well, let's begin our time of worship. We center ourselves in faith. We center ourselves on Christ, and we prepare our hearts and our minds to worship. As the candles on the altar are lighted, we are reminded of God's presence in this place, the light that comes into the darkness, and that the darkness cannot overcome the light. So we hear our prelude as we begin. Precious Lord, take my hand. Mm-hmm.
This morning I went over to Duff Street United Methodist Church for their early service. It was to be partly dedicated to consecrating Andy Fowler's ministry as a certified lay minister. Their praise band played music and sang for about 20 minutes. And one of the songs had lyrics like, "It's a good day. Every day is a good day. I'm a child of God. I am blessed. I am truly blessed." I hope and pray that we can all say that. Consider this now. And in the silence we breathe out, knowing that God, our closest breath, is with us. In the stillness, we join with all of creation and hold silence together. Let's be still for a moment, just as we draw near to worship God. Take a few seconds to remind yourself why we are gathered here today. Listen. God speaks even through the background noise of the world around us. Stand if you're able for our call to worship as we join together. Can you hear the voice of God? Are you troubled or distressed? Come and find a guide who knows these lands. Our hymn of praise this morning, it is in your United Methodist hymnal, red hymnal, number 140, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Thy faithfulness,
Thank you.
be seated. Let us pray. Lord God, in this short time together, open our eyes to see your vision for this place and our part in it. Teach us to hear our prayers and enable us for service wherever you might take us. To your praise and glory. Amen.
Amen.
The word from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We now have some special music which Lindy will bring to us.
Our scripture lesson for today comes from Peter's first epistle, here a few weeks ago, and we continue to spend some time hearing from Peter, but today we come to the second chapter, and we hear verses 19 through 25. I invite you to follow along as we hear these words from the Apostle Peter. Now it is commendable if, because of one's understanding of God, someone should endure pain through suffering unjustly. But what praise comes from enduring patiently when you have sinned and are beaten for it? But if you endure steadfastly when you've done good and suffer for it, this is commendable before God. You were called to this kind of endurance because Christ suffered on your behalf. He left you an example so that you might follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, nor did he ever speak in ways meant to deceive. When he was insulted, he did not reply with insults. When he suffered, he did not threaten revenge. Instead, he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He carried in his own body on the cross the sins we committed. He did this so that we might live in righteousness, having nothing to do with sin. By his wounds you were healed. Though you were like straying sheep, you have now returned to the shepherd and guardian of your lives. And this, my brothers and sisters, is the word of God for the people.
Before God.
Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, we give to you our thanks and our praise for these words from the Apostle Peter. Lord, we thank you for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, for the victory over sin and death, and Lord, even for our own promised resurrection. Lord, let your word come alive in our hearts that we may live it out with faith in the world. And now let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Our scripture lesson for today continues Peter's first epistle to the church, a church that is dispersed, a church that has left the Holy Land and is now scattered throughout the region, particularly in five Roman provinces, as we shared last week. And we shared last week also kind of that beginning to Paul, Peter's first epistle. That wonderful greeting that he shares. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's chosen strangers in the world of the diaspora who live in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. God the Father chose you because of what he knew before you. He chose you through the Holy Spirit's work of making you holy, because of the faithful obedience and sacrifice of Jesus Christ. May God's grace and peace be multiplied to you. What a wonderful greeting that Peter shares to the church. And Peter goes on in the second chapter and tells the church this, something that's extended to us as well. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people who are God's own possession. You have become this people so that you may speak of the wonderful acts of the one who called you out of darkness and into his amazing light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received. And in these earlier passages, Peter is identifying his audience. He's proclaiming their newfound identity in Jesus Christ. And you see, these folks were dispersed and exiled from their homeland. They become refugees in a foreign land in those five Roman provinces. And then he shifts his tone and begins to talk about their new lives as strangers in the world. Strangers in the world. A people longing to be at home with God. And it's here that he offers our lesson for today about suffering and submission. Now, it's quite peculiar. We just celebrated Easter a couple weeks ago. Great joy and great liberation, great freedom. The bondage of sin and death has been overcome in the victory of Christ's resurrection. And here we are on this now fourth Sunday of Easter talking about suffering and submission. Anybody here like to suffer? Anybody here really like to be in submission? We don't like to suffer. We don't like to be in submission. But Peter has a very wise word for us here. A couple years ago, we shared together in a study on spiritual disciplines. Some of you may have been a part of that. And we talked a lot about outward disciplines, those disciplines that we outwardly show in our walk of faith. And in fact, submission is one of those outward disciplines. Now, the study itself was based on Richard Foster's book, Celebration of Discipline. And in his book, Foster says this: the biblical teaching on submission focuses primarily on the spirit with which we view other people. Scripture does not attempt to set forth a series of hierarchical relationships, but to communicate to us an inner attitude of mutual subordination. Peter, for example, calls upon the slaves of his day to live in submission to their masters. The counsel seems unnecessary until we realize that it is quite possible for servants to obey their masters without living in a spirit of submission around them. Outwardly, we can do what people ask of us, and at the same time, inwardly be in rebellion against them. This concern for a spirit of consideration toward others pervades the entire New Testament, Foster says. And the Old Covenant stipulated that we must not murder. We remember that, one of the great commandments, not the greatest, but one of the great commandments, thou shalt not murder. Jesus, however, stressed that the real issue was not that, but it was the inner spirit of murder with which we view people. In the matter of submission, the very same thing is true. The real issue is the spirit of consideration and respect that we have for each other. Not just on the outside, but on the inside as well. And so for Christ, the cross itself was the ultimate sign of suffering and submission. For us today, that suffering and submission comes in many different ways. Maybe our boss is giving us a really hard time when we don't deserve it. Perhaps a coworker who was less qualified was offering a promotion and we've worked our tail ends off. Maybe we didn't get picked as team captain even though we've been the first to arrive and the last to leave. And always gave everything our all. Or perhaps we observe those things happening to friends, to family, our children, those within our congregation, and even those in our friendship circles. We see it, and we feel it. And the truth is that it happens. It is inevitable, and it hurts. We look beyond the walls of our own home and even this church building and we see suffering every day. We see the physical suffering of those who hunger from food insecurity and those battling addiction. We see the financial struggling of that single parent trying to raise a family. We see the emotional suffering of those battling health issues, both physically and mentally. And we see people who are suffering because of their faith. They're put down, cast away, and even put to death. And the great reality of this is that many of these people, in fact, probably most of these people, are people like you. People who say that they believe in Jesus Christ. They may not come to church, but that doesn't mean that they are not believers. Maybe they're you and me. But even in the great midst of all of that suffering, even in the midst of that hurt and that heartache, God is still there. A great question for us as a people of faith is this. As we look around and as we see the world hurting and suffering, even one another, are we willing to submit ourselves to suffering for the sake of others? Are we willing to offer ourselves in the name of Jesus Christ to bring about justice and mercy to someone we love or perhaps even a total stranger? And it might come as a sacrifice of time or money. It might mean that we sacrifice this or that. But we think again about the words from the gospel writer John as he said that man has no greater love than to give up one's life for one's friend. Now, we're not asking you to be put to death for someone. But think about this for just a moment. In a moment of hurt or fear or anxiety or great suffering, about how great it feels to know that we are not alone, to be surrounded by the love and the grace and compassion of one another, and to be able to come and to share in someone's suffering. As we look back on Good Friday and remember Christ crucified, there again we see that ultimate example of suffering and submission. We know that Jesus did not want to really be crucified on that cross. But he submitted himself to God. He said, Father, if it's your will, take away this cup of suffering from me. We feel the pain, the agony, the dread of the suffering that lie ahead. But Jesus goes on and says, however, not my will, but your will must be done. And so here, not only do we see suffering, but we see submission. And Christ did this so that we might live in righteousness. And indeed, by his wounds, we are healed. That once we were a people straying like lost sheep, but now we have a shepherd and guardian of our lives who is Christ the Lord. And indeed, Jesus paid it all through his suffering and submission. We are called to share in that suffering and submission with Christ. As Peter reminds us in our scripture lesson today, now it is commendable if, because of one's understanding of God, one should endure pain through suffering unjustly. If you endure steadfastly when you've done good and suffer for it, this is commendable before God. Indeed, God is with us. Even as we journey through the valley of the shadow of death, we know that death does not have the final word. Jesus told his disciples, in this life you will have trouble. You will have trouble. You will suffer. You will endure hardship. But be of courage, one translation puts it. Be of courage because I have overcome the world. And indeed, we are assured of God's very presence with us always. Through the darkest struggles and sufferings of life, there is God. And I'll close with these words, the 23rd Psalm, paraphrased in the Message. And I want you to close your eyes and just picture this in your mind's eye, because the words are powerful. God, my shepherd. I don't need a thing. You have bedded me down in lush meadows. You find me quiet pools to drink from. True to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Even when the way goes through Death Valley, I'm not afraid when you walk at my side. Your trusty shepherd's crook makes me feel secure. You serve me a six-course dinner right in front of my enemies. You revive my drooping head. My cup brims with blessing. Your beauty and love chase after me every day of my life. I'm back home in the house of God for the rest of my life. As an Easter people, we will suffer in this life. We will suffer unjustly and unmercifully by the world. As an Easter people, we must submit ourselves to God. We must live as the 23rd Psalm invites us. And as an Easter people, we must love and serve one another. And that's important. And then as an Easter people, we too will rise in victory at the mighty name of Jesus Christ, and there dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
Indeed, the thought of suffering and submission is probably anything that we think we would ever hear in church. We like to think of faith as rainbows and butterflies, the prosperity gospel, goodness and mercy alone. But each of us has endured and will, in the remainder of our lives here on earth, suffer and endure hardships and feel heartbreak and know loss and fear and anxiety even in the moment of our last breath. But take a breath. Take a breath and know that God is with us in the midst of that suffering. Embrace it. And just as Jesus submitted himself to the will of God, so too should we submit ourselves and thus be launched from this life into that boundless realm of eternity that has no end. Victory at last. Forever. In the name of Jesus Christ. May it be so. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
As we continue in our time of worship, and as we hear the very word of God, we have an opportunity to respond. And not just to say any words without meaning, not a series of words and sentences of I think or I feel or maybe if then, but words affirming our faith that begin with I believe. So let's join together as we lift up our voices together, professing our faith, we use the words from the Apostles' Creed. Together, let us say what we believe. I believe in God the Father,
maker of heaven and earth,
and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit.
Born of the Virgin Mary, son of her Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and the life of the everlasting.
Amen.
As we receive our offering today, we remind you that there are offering plates in the front of the sanctuary and in the back of the sanctuary as well, that you can place any tithes and offerings that you wish to leave here today as we worship. For those joining us in the virtual world, know that you can mail those into the church office, and we will gratefully receive those as a part of our weekly offering. But above all, we are reminded that our offering is extended on these offering plates to who we are. And as we share together in our baptismal covenant, we commit ourselves to be faithful to the ministries of Christ's church through our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Not just anyone, but all of them together. And this is our holy offering that we make and dedicate here to the Lord on this day. So I invite you to stand as we join together in our doxology. We dedicate these, our gifts and our offerings today. Number 95 in our United Methodist Temple. Stand as you're. Share a time of joys and concerns and lifting up our prayers. I just want to say again what a joy it was for our pancake fundraiser yesterday. We had the opportunity to meet some new neighbors and to greet some, to greet many strangers, people we had never met before, people that we have met, people within our congregation, and people from outside of the community. Was a wonderful, wonderful opportunity just to be in fellowship with one another and to share in some good pancakes. Also want to keep Cheryl Means in prayer. Cheryl was in a vehicle accident earlier this week and doing well, but just at home, kind of recovering from the bumps and bruises there. But do keep her in prayer if you'd like to send a thinking of you card or even a get well card. I'm sure she would appreciate that, but nothing major, but as I said, the bumps and bruises of being in a vehicle accident can be kind of painful, even if they're not really major things. So we want to surround her in prayer. What other prayers can we lift up this morning? Joy's concerns as well. Go ahead, Donna.
Yeah, my mom went to the hospital this past week. We just recently just got her out. Her name's Mary Beth Paul, and we are a long way away from seeing things better. The urinary tract they were able to fix, and they were able to temporarily fix the white count and the red count to get it halfway stable. And we're waiting for the cancer center to set up a next appointment so we can deal with the stomach issue at this point in time. Thank you. And also an international request just came in. Prayers for Thailand. I'm not sure how to pronounce the section of Thailand. But according to what this is showing me, is they the earth has really shook over there big time. That's all the information I have at this point. The international it just came over Facebook.
People that, like Nella, you know, I don't want to name a bunch of them because I'll forget somebody. see and people that just aren't able to get here at this time, you know, for whatever reason. I'm in prayer for grandchildren.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Oh God, there are many people, many situations, many things in our minds and on our hearts this morning. And Lord, we know that you walk with us. You know that all things work together for good, even in the midst of suffering and difficulties of life. But Lord, today we come and we worship you because we know that only in and through you do we have help, do we have life, do we have salvation. So, Lord, for your great love in Christ, we worship you. And we come and we give to you our thanks and praise for opportunities to minister together and to be in fellowship with one another, to meet and greet new people. For our pancake fundraiser that we shared in yesterday. And, Lord, for many people who we've named today. For Cheryl, for those who have been healed in mighty ways through medical care teams. Even when things seem grim and scary, Lord, you call us back to life. For Jerry's mother, Mary Beth, for people in Thailand, for those battling with natural disasters, earthquakes and fires and storms. And we pray for those that we haven't seen in a while, for those who are not able to be with us, that we might reach out, send a card, call and share God's love with them in meaningful ways. We pray for grandchildren, for grandparents, for family, even our family here in the church. And Father, we pray for your church, for that ministry to which you call us, for new and exciting ways to begin new ministries together. And we pray for our United Methodist Church, especially our congregation in the midst of this season of pastoral transitions and church realignments. Lord, the future is bright, if we would but see it and carry onward the flame that you have given to us. We pray for all of our leaders, both in the world and within the church. For those who have departed this life, that we remember and celebrate in our hearts. Lord, for all of the ways in which we have failed as followers, disciples of Christ, and pray that you give us strength and courage to get up and to carry on. So, Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. Invigorate each of us into your church in new and exciting ways. we would be faithful as we submit ourselves to you and to that call that you have given to us. And so, Lord, for all of this, we give to you our thanks and praise, knowing that you are with us and at work. And we pray as you taught your disciples to pray when you said,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thy kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
As we prepare now to go forth, we invite you to stand as we join together in our hymn of response from the Faith We Say hymnal, the Black Paper Book hymnal. Let's stand as we join together, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. Stand as you're able, we join together in singing. Truer words perhaps have never been sung. The world will know we are Christians by our love, or lack thereof. So, having received the very love of God on go forth into the world and share that love of God with others. And thus, indeed, they will know that we are Christians. We go forth in the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Okay, folks, I'd like to thank the following people off of Facebook, most of Jimmy Steppage, Langer and Brew, and Stacy Stickler, and also Sarah Lamp. I know she'll be stopping by here later, and a lot of people, and a lot more people should be stopped by this video, as always. Also, to look this up on YouTube, look up Stealey Methodist Church, Clarksburg, West Virginia, USA. That is Stealey Methodist Church off the YouTube channel. But I got a book going right here. So thank you all for watching. We appreciate it as always. Peace. Grace and peace. Aloha. We serve men, women, serving around the world. No ranch for your military intervention. We love you, madly, right here. Peace out. We'll talk at y'all soon.